This episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by TouringPlans.com. Spend less time in line and more time riding your favorite attractions. Visit TouringPlans.com.
Hey everybody, it's Stacy from Must Do Disney, and you are in the place to be, the Disney Nerds Podcast. Check it out.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the Magic Worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 474 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. My name's Ed, and on this week's show, well, we're going to be talking about the live events at Walt Disney World. To help me do that, I've got a couple of guys on the show with me tonight. First off is Jimmy. Hey, Jimmy, how's it going?
What's happening?
Not much. How are you doing?
I just was watching. I hadn't seen the new Ant-Man yet, but I was watching the Ant-Man and the Wasp, I think it was, where the dude pulls up. I forgot his name, the funny guy.
Right.
And he's, what's that?
Michael Pena, like, I think it is.
Yeah, Michael Pena. He's like, you don't remember when that was a thing? What's happening? So I'm bringing that back. Yeah,
there
bringing
you go. That back. We'll see what happens. We also have Sam from Sam's Disney Diary with us tonight. Hey, Sam, how's it going?
What's up, guys? It feels like a reunion of sorts. It's pretty cool.
Yep, fun little show. So what we're going to talk about tonight are some of the live things, and we've been talking about this the last couple of weeks, of all the different live things that are coming back to Walt Disney World.
There's so lots of stuff coming back, dude.
Well, that's the thing. All of it's coming back.
Magic Kingdom, did you see Enchanted Tales of Belle?
That's what I was just going to say. Yeah, that just came back this past week. So we keep hearing different things as they're coming back. There's stuff that's back that we haven't even heard the announcement that it's back. So what we're going to do this week is we're going to talk about all the live things at the Walt Disney World parks that you can experience. A lot of people think they're going to the parks to get on the rides. Get on the rides. Get on the rides. There's a lot more to do than just rides at Walt Disney World. And I think what you're going to hear tonight is a lot about that.
I would argue that there are some of the best things to do in Walt Disney World are things other than rides.
So I 100% agree, but I've been visiting attractions. I don't know what a ride is.
That's an attraction. Yeah, it's true.
I'm kidding.
Walt Disney World, though, and that's a term that we always have. Like the Disney nerds always talk about, it's an attraction, not a ride. However, there are rides at Disney World.
I still think Dumbo
is a ride. So there are rides, there are attractions, there are shows. And what we're going to talk about mostly today are those shows. So what we'll do is we're going to go each type of entertainment, and then we're going to hit park by park. And I think we're going to cover a lot of it. So ready to start?
Let's do it, man.
Sounds good to me.
Very cool. So one of the main things that we always go to the parks to kind of do is to get into some of the shows. And Walt Disney World has some of the best shows offered around. They've got Broadway quality type of shows that are really fun to experience. Along with that, they have some, I want to say, like, traveling type shows and things like that they do have around the different parts of the parks. So we're going to hit Animal Kingdom first and talk about some of the shows they have there. And I got to tell you, by starting with Animal Kingdom and their shows, we actually are raising the bar pretty high for the rest of the parks.
We are, dude. Surprisingly, Animal Kingdom has a lot of great entertainment. The Broadway caliber shows you just talked about, two of those, and some great entertainment just all over that park.
Yeah, I would argue two of the best shows in Walt Disney World are in Animal Kingdom.
Yeah.
Oh, I totally agree. And the first one we're going to talk about is the one that's been there the longest, Festival of the Lion King. So now the big announcement with Festival of the Lion King is that the entire show now is back to its pre-COVID standing. So all the different parts of the show are back. Tumble Monkeys came back last summer. That was like the biggest news. And this year now, basically, all the different parts are back. The only one I want to question is if are they doing the animal noises? That I want to see if that ever comes back, because I think
I mean, like, just... when the crowd first gets there and they get everybody fired up, is that
further on in the show, they have to, each of the animal sections makes the animal sections noise, and yes, we all compete. So you have the lion section, you have the
and nobody knows the giraffe section,
you have the giraffe section where everybody's like just baffled.
Nobody knows what the sounds of giraffe makes.
You know what I love about what you just said, introducing that, Ed? We're back to pre-pandemic. And I think that's going to be a consistent for everything that we talk about. And it's awesome because, oh my gosh, we wanted that for so long to just get back to where we were. And we're I love it.
I will say I have not seen Festival of the Lion King since, you know, we saw it. The last time I saw it, they didn't have the Tumble Monkeys and they didn't have the acrobat at the end, the bird acrobat at the end. And it was sorely missed. It wasn't the same show without those two things going on. And I'm not saying it wasn't entertaining, but it was definitely like not as good of a show without with those missing.
Right. And that falls into the category, if you've seen the entire show before, then yeah, you're definitely missing some of the parts. But if you have never seen it and you saw those like kind of shortened show, it wouldn't have been that bad. Yeah. And the other show at Animal Kingdom is, of course, Finding Nemo. Finding Nemo, The Big Blue, and Beyond. We have to add that now. Which is kind of weird how the title has grown much longer. However, the show has shrunken up a bit.
So, yeah, I'm waiting for them to get back to pre-pandemic with that one, too.
Right. But the show itself is pretty phenomenal. The show gave Finding Nemo lyrics and music. It had the music before, but now it's got the lyrics, and I can't watch Finding Nemo without trying to sing the songs that aren't in the cartoon, in the movie.
It's so crazy that I'd seen Finding Nemo the musical so many times, and then went back and watched Finding Nemo and realized, like, God, none of those songs are in here. Like, it has no songs. Yeah. I just didn't remember it because in my mind, you know, it just kind of melded the two together, and that I felt like that music should have been in the movie.
That music is awesome because they used it both for The Big Blue and Beyond, and they used it over at the Seas with Nemo.
Over at Epcot.
I just think it's cool. And you can hear it over at, not Pop Century, at Art of Animation Underwater. That's
me
cooler,
and right? Me and Lisa had this question come up between the two of us on one of the shows. This is a few years ago, but where did it appear first? Was it in the Seas with Nemo and Epcot, or the musical? It was simultaneous.
I was going to say Epcot. If I had to guess,
yeah, it was simultaneous. That makes sense. They came out at the same time, and it was simultaneous.
Right. Yeah, that was a great discovery finding that out. Very cool cohesion. Okay, so let's move parks. So we're going over to Hollywood Studios, where you got to imagine they're going to have some good shows too, being Hollywood Studios and such. And the main show, which has been around for a while, and there's been so many different rumors about it going away, and I think it's definitely going to be around with us for a little bit more, is the Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular.
I like how you called that the main show. Is that because that's Ed's main show?
No, I think it's the main show because as you walk into the park and you come to the lake, that takes up a big, big chunk of real estate before you start going into other parts of the park.
Well, you would turn off right and go to, before you even got to that area, you could turn right and go to Beauty and the Beast.
True, you could. However, you're still walking in toward Grumman's Chinese Theater. That's my theory behind that's the main part of the park.
Okay.
Because that's the main weenie you see from when you walk in the door.
And you walk past the Frozen sing-along to get to Indiana Jones.
Which is easy to do. That's not a hard thing to do. But that is the other show. Jimmy brought up our other second show.
You're going to both of those. Little girl, we're going to Beauty and the Beast, and we're going to Frozen.
Yeah, correct. Sure. I think Indiana Jones has been there the longest. It probably is. It's a great draw. I was just giving Ed some grief.
Indiana Jones is a reliable show, too. That's awesome.
Probably his favorite, I'm sure. So that's why we went there first, but... It's a great show. No, not your favorite?
It's not. It's a great show. I'm just, you know, there's other shows that are better. It's just a good show at Hollywood Studios.
Hollywood Studios?
Sure. Over what, Frozen? Because Frozen is really the only other, isn't that the only other show, per se?
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast is a show.
Oh, that's true. That's true. No, it's still better than that.
Okay.
So, easy enough. So, yeah. So, first time in forever, a Frozen sing-along celebration was the other one we were talking about. And the last one, Beauty and the Beast live on stage.
All good.
They're all very good. Our friend Mark Daniel, Disney MC and cast member, performs in two of the three of those. He is sometimes in Indiana Jones, and sometimes he is in the Frozen sing-along as one of the. I like the Frozen sing-along because it's funny.
Sure.
They had to add something for the parents in there, and they did a great job.
It's hilarious. They do those actors do an incredible job in that.
Yeah, because the actual people from Frozen are really kind of minor parts in that. Actually, and to be honest,
The two townspeople that run everything and really keep it really funny. And some of those people were actually Streetmosphere people at one time.
True. Yep, you are correct. And Beauty and the Beast live on stage. That is one of the closest things, I think, to the cruise ship type of Broadway shows that you're going to come across in any of the parks, because of it's not really long, but it tells a complete story. It's a familiar story. The songs are pretty right on. And it's a great place to kind of sit down, relax in the kind of middle of the day.
It is. I enjoy all three of those are really good options. To catch that you can, if you're passing by and they're letting people in, it's always a good idea to walk into one of those theaters. And I give maybe Frozen the slight edge during the summer because it is indoors.
Yes,
and sure. That theater is always very, like, the temperature wise, it's very cool.
It's frozen. It should be.
And yeah, Indiana correct. Jones and snow. Frozen theaters are pretty big. So even if the show is getting ready to start, you have a good chance of getting in there. Actually, Indiana Jones, the last time I was there, shocked me because the entire set of seats were filled up, and then they were letting us sit and stand on the back wall. Like, you know, you have that back, like, pathway that goes behind all the stands. Well, they have that back wall then. It's only about 3 or 4 feet tall, and we were all sitting and standing on that. So they really packed it.
And we didn't mention this when we were in Animal Kingdom, but I would say Finding Nemo the same way. You could almost walk in almost at the end, and they'll squeeze you in there. Lion King, probably not. You may have trouble. You may get shut out of there and have to wait till the next show. Any of these other shows, I feel like you could walk in right up to the last minute, and they'll squeeze you in the theater some kind of way.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So now at Epcot, I'm not too sure there's any shows, so to speak, the way we're talking about at this point. Of course, they got the Cinema 360s and things like that, but no real shows. We're going to have some entertainment. We're going to have some character interactions, and we'll talk about those in a little bit.
Yeah, no stage shows, I guess. I mean, you do have the band and
For the festivals, Canada.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. That's a great point to bring up. The shows in Canada, because that is a stage, they do change out somewhat now, where it's not always the same act. But that has been active, definitely. And we'll talk about a little bit more of the entertainment, but yeah, there's always something going on in Epcot. That's definitely
around World Showcase, and there's a couple stages that come to mind, the Mill stage being one. There's one in Morocco, there's a new one in Germany that's permanent there now, and there's always something going on there.
Sure. And of course the main stage in America, which is
the Garden Theater.
Sure. And any of the festivals have their amount of concerts that happen there for that. Yeah. That's always to be considered and always kind of to be planned around.
Even at this point, off festival, when you're there in the summer and you're in between festivals, they'll have Voices of Liberty or Mariachi Cobra playing in there. In the American Gardens Theater.
That's cool.
Sure. And Voices of Liberty, I think that's a character interaction, but that could be considered a show also over at the American Pavilion. So that's another good one too. So I take back what I said about Epcot having no shows.
Well, but they're a little less traditional. They're not stage shows like Broadway type shows, like right. like we were talking about before. There are differences, right.
yeah, and, absolutely, and
compared to the other ones.
Yep, good point. Going over to the Magic Kingdom, again, the same thing as far as a formal stage show. We've got Mickey's Magical Friendship Fair, which is the stage show right in front of the castle. I don't usually watch those shows. Not a big fan of them. I usually, you'll see the fireworks kind of at the end of the show from all different parts of the park as my day goes on. That's about my extent for it.
If I'm like walking up Main Street and there's one going on, I may walk up, you know, close enough to watch for a couple minutes, but they usually don't hold my attention. However, if you're there with a young, with a child who wants to see these characters, you know, they're probably a must do.
Oh, no doubt. And usually it's not that crowded, believe it or not, for the shows up in front of the castle. It's nothing like the fireworks, nothing like parades or anything like that. It's a nice, relaxed kind of sit.
You can usually walk up pretty darn close to the stage and, you know, get a good view of the characters and stuff like that. And if you can sell your kids on that's the character interaction and you don't have to wait in line later to meet them, it may save you some time. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Parental hack right there.
You don't remember when you met Mickey on the stage?
You got the picture of him. The kids in front of him. He's dancing like 40 feet behind them.
Yeah, correct.
Okay, so now another really cool...
It's closer than the pandemic, kid.
Oh, I know, right?
6 feet, kids.
And speaking of kids, another one of the interactions that we always try to get at the parks, especially for the 12 and under crowd, are the character meet and greets. Or just trying to meet up type of characters and things like that.
I have visited with people and that is all they wanted to do. As many character meets as they could do all day long. Do that instead of attractions. Do that instead of stage shows. That's what they wanted. And
Sam,
get the pictures, get the autographs.
Think right? about the people that buy tickets to Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party and Mickey's Very Merry Christmas Party just for the characters that you see, because you see so many characters that you don't normally see.
Different ones,
so you'll have people buy tickets for those parties specifically to character hunt.
You're absolutely right. And it's big. It's big.
It is. There is one website that I do know of. I'm not sure actually how up to date he's been recently, but Kenny the Pirate had been great as far as he lists every character, every park. However, I want to tell you, Disney's website has caught up with that. So as we're looking through the different parks, you get to see some of the characters they have, although they can throw characters at you any given time. So you never can tell, and you can always be surprised, which is a great thing.
We just got some new characters, which is awesome. February 1st, they introduced some, including Max over at Hollywood Studios. Max Goof is now a character. That's awesome.
I've seen Max... And Goofy.
He's been at special events.
Now he's all day.
I saw him post-pandemic. I saw him at out in front the entrance of Tower of Terror, him and Goofy. I actually have a video of that.
What, so this Max that they have now is dressed in the power line costume?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if it was that or not. It's the Max from the Goofy movie. Yeah.
This was shorts and shorts and whatever.
I love Max.
Yeah. Now, when you're going through the parks, and this is kind of due to the pandemic, I think, in a little way, you're going to see characters in two different ways. You're going to do the old traditional meet and greets now, which had just come back over the last year, year and a half, where you can actually stand in line, walk up to a character, talk to them, have an autograph, get some pictures taken. But then they also have some character, I want to call them character appearances, perhaps, or character events. Take for Animal Kingdom, for example. Since the pandemic started, they actually were pretty quick in getting their characters still out in front of the public by putting them on pontoon boats and sending the characters, the flotilla of characters, around the different rivers of Animal Kingdom and basically just being there for us to see, waving, saying hello, things like that.
And they still
do it, which I think is great as far as keeping it going.
Along those same lines, that's the cavalcades. They came during the pandemic to replace the parades because they didn't do the big parades. They just did the not scheduled. They come out every once in a while. But now we're seeing it at Magic Kingdom and at Animal Kingdom and even at studios. Those cavalcades have stuck. they're still going on today. And I think families pretty love cool. it because just the quick interaction. Here comes a car with Mickey and Minnie in the back of it. It drives down Hollywood Boulevard and it's cool.
And you got to think in some way it does control crowds, meaning you all of a sudden have a big group of people stopping, watching that cavalcade. And it's almost like those stoplights as you're getting on the highways where they stop you on the ramp. So you kind of get people kind of staggered as you're moving around. You get the flow staggered in the parks. Might be digging a little deep there, but you never know.
I also like, and we've seen more of this in the past few years than you did at one time, but Disneyland has a lot of free roaming characters. They're not just stuck in one spot. They walk around a lot. And you see that a little bit in Walt Disney World. That's where the random ones are. Yeah, not that long ago, I was in Memento Mori, the store by Haunted Mansion, and Peter Pan stuck his head in the doorway, and he wanders around a lot in that area. Now, obviously, that's as far as he can go because that's the cutoff between Fantasyland and Liberty Square. And then also the evil stepsisters they'll roam around Fantasyland and interact with people. And just a stationary meet and greet. They kind of go off.
They're on the borderline of Streetmosphere, those guys, I think.
Correct.
Yeah.
I think those interactions are just so much more cooler than the ones where they're just standing and you're waiting in line and you walk up and take a picture and move on, you know.
But you're not going to get as much from them. Those, like the stepsisters, they're moving around, they're greeting people, things like that. They're moving. You'll get a little bit more personal experience when you do wait in line. It'll be just you.
That's true. But if somebody like me who's just watching the whole thing happen, it's much cooler to watch than. Definitely.
There was a video that just got posted this week. I forget where, our YouTube or whatever, of a couple of little girls who were dressed like the evil stepsisters, and the stepsisters freaked out over them. They just couldn't stop. It was great.
That's cool.
I think we'd be, missing the boat if we didn't talk about those roaming characters in Galaxy's Edge.
Yeah,
because all of their characters pretty much roam around. They walk through and.
They roam around and they stick to the story, and they're good. Man.
They're really good at it.
If you're going to do that, all the cast members at Galaxy's Edge are definitely sticking to their stories.
Yeah, for sure.
So Animal Kingdom, the normal stand in line meet and greets they have there. Meet favorite Disney pals at Adventure Outpost is the big location in Animal Kingdom. So that's going to be Mickey and pals. Figure that.
Mickey and Minnie mostly.
Sure. Yeah. Oh, okay. Also, we have Donald's Dino Bash, which is kind of like I don't know if it's on a schedule, but they basically it'll be Donald Duck, Daisy Duck, and it's over in Dino Land on that dead end street right in front of Chester and Hester's. Usually is where they'll show up, and they'll come out with a couple different characters.
Construction walls.
Well, that's where they perform now. I bet right in front of there.
Well, I'm sure. Yeah.
There's a lot of room over there. A lot of space.
Who else is there? Somebody else is there.
Goofy and Pluto there before the Dino Bash.
No, there's somebody else just in Animal Kingdom.
And get used to this because Disney will list the characters on their website. They don't even come close to listing all the characters that will be walking around, though. That's the hard part.
Yeah, it is cool. Just watch them coming.
Are they not still doing Doug there from Up? The dog from Up?
Oh, he was over.
I haven't seen Doug in a while.
Near the entrance to A Bug's Life.
Because
that's where the little interpreter is, where you walk into it and it tells you what you said. They hang out there. And I think that Kevin's been hanging around there.
He's a roaming around character.
He's absolutely.
Thing's amazing. That thing's so cool.
So let's hop over to Hollywood Studios. And some of the more novel characters they have over there have been there for actually a little while. Some of the coolest ones to my family have always been, not always because they haven't been there forever, but the Army soldiers, the Toy Story Love Army them. Soldiers walking Love around. They do so many different types of acts we've seen too.
Love that they're back. They get the balls. They get the kids involved. They start the march and
drums and things like that. So that's pretty cool. And they all have some specific things over there, which I think is really cool too. They have a Sully meet and greet. You've got a Disney Junior pals meet and greet which is over at the courtyard.
The animation courtyard, yeah.
Oh, I'm sure. And that's got to rotate through a lot of different characters, I got to imagine, too.
That has been through, just looking at Disney Junior, before it was, what is it now? It's Playhouse Disney, right?
I think so, yeah.
It used to be Disney Junior, or maybe I'm backwards. Somebody's yelling at me right now because they have, my kids are a little older now, but it went through three names when I was watching it, and it went through, Handy Mandy was there for a little while. I think so from right. The first is there, then Vampirina's over there, and
Bear
the
and the Big Blue House. Bear and the Big Blue House was there. Yeah, Bear. Yeah,
that was the best. House.
Sure. There's so many franchises that came and went. The Captain Hook one, the Peter Pan, so many franchises. I love it.
Yeah,
it changes a lot.
I want to see that entire courtyard taken over by Disney Junior or Disney Playhouse or whatever. I think they could do so much with that, and something for the little kids.
We mentioned two things now, and that's a whole topic for another show, sure. Which is what happens in that area, because Little Mermaid is one of the things, a show that didn't come back, by the way. And I don't know that that's going to come back. That could be done. And, of course, over where the roller coaster's gone now in Animal Kingdom, we were talking about. Those two areas, something's got to give, man. Yeah. Something's got to give.
We will see. Some of the other meet and greets, we have the Toy Story characters are always walking around. I always see Woody by his big Woody statue, which is kind of an odd thing.
Yep.
Meet Olaf. Which is kind of funny because, unfortunately, Olaf has that area by the bathrooms over by Star Tours, right around the corner from the Frozen sing-along. But it's still, you know, if you want to meet Olaf, he is there.
Yeah, it's by the Mickey Mouse Vacation shorts.
Yes. Love that short, by the way. Watch
Potato
that
Land. If I could go to Potato Land, yeah. I would.
Potato Land.
And Olaf actually did double duty because you'll see him over at Epcot, too.
How'd he do it?
He just is amazing. So let's jump over to Epcot. And Epcot has absolutely the most amount of character meets.
And you're absolutely right. And I'm still waiting to see what we're going to get when this transformation of Epcot finishes and we have all of the districts of it. What are they calling them? Districts or lands or whatever. The World Celebration.
Neighborhoods.
That's it. When we get the neighborhoods. But just around World Showcase itself, you get any character that matches the country and boom, Snow White's in Germany.
I think those are great that you can walk by and you can see Aurora in France.
Yep.
And Belle in France. And so I think those are cool because you don't see they're all indoors in Magic Kingdom. Right. So you're not just walking around and you can't just walk around and see them. You have to go wait in line because I'm not going to wait in line really to see them. Maybe Sleeping Beauty because it's my wife's favorite. We may wait in line for that. But
I got to do what you got to do.
Yeah, but they also pop in and out of there. So there's usually not a ton of lines.
Right.
Compared to the meet and greets in Magic Kingdom.
And what's cool is that the website and the app for a lot of the Epcot characters don't have, like, they're there from 9 a.m. till, like, 5 p.m. They have specific times. Yeah. So Snow White, 9:30, 10:45, 11:55. So if you really do want to meet this character, you could kind of be a little bit, you know, preemptive, get there a couple minutes beforehand and get in front of that line.
Depending on the day, those lines kind of close fast. There's always a character attendant. And the princess will come out and the line will form. And I don't know how many they're counting, but at some point the character attendant goes, okay, that's it, no more. And they get through that line and the princess goes and comes back in an hour.
Sure.
But you need to hang around if that's something you want to do.
I was going to say, that's one of the only things the kids have going for them at World Showcase. I mean, they've got KidCot and they've got character meet and greets. Other than that, food and booze really aren't up the kids' alley.
Well, and I was going to say the Snow White meet and greet is pretty amazing because of the area with the fountain.
Yeah.
With Snow White's fountain. I mean, it's completely themed. I mean, you know, like Belle meets out by the waterway in France. It's not, it's fine, but it's not, Sleeping Beauty has her own little area. I mean, Snow White has her own little area with her wishing well, and it's done really well.
Just to quickly go through some of the characters that Disney does list, which, and again, remember, this is the list of the characters that are definitely there. There's always more characters that are randomly there. But as Sam mentioned, we have Snow White in Germany, Belle in France. which they only list Belle, but I have seen Beast with Belle in France too, as a couple.
Yeah.
Anna, Elsa, and I remember seeing Olaf in there too, over in Norway.
And Elsa are in their place, right? They got them.
They have a house. Yeah, that's an indoor.
They're inside, and that line is usually fairly long. And we have to remember when they built that for Anna and Elsa, Frozen was the thing.
Yes.
So you couldn't just, you probably couldn't just pop them up outside somewhere because it had been a mob. Well,
they tried that when the movie first went out. I was there with my niece. There was a 3.5 hour line all around Norway because they had them in the store at the very end of the store. They were in there and the line went just all the way down to China and back.
Oh, sure.
China and back. That's kind of funny.
That's funny. That's a good show. Moving over to Mexico, we've got Donald, who is a perfect fit there. That's awesome for him.
With the sombrero. I mean, he's in character. And it's,
oh, sure. Love that. No doubt. And that's a nice little meet and greet because he's got the ruins behind him and that whole little area to the right side of Mexico.
So you get three caballeros.
Oh, that's awesome. I would love to see all three. I would love to see all three there someday.
Oh, that
would
be cool.
I have seen the red guy. So anyway. Yeah.
Jose. They're on one of the cavalcades over at Magic Kingdom.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, well, they are.
Sure. Yeah. Mulan is over in China, live character. Alice over in the UK. Jasmine over in Morocco.
Mary I haven't Poppins actually seen in Jasmine the UK.
Yes, that's right. She has been there too. You're right.
Right
in the corner by the tea shop.
Yep. Jasmine is inside, Ed. It's in the back of Morocco, like in the sangria. When you're where they sell the sangria, there's a building that just
in the back.
Go inside. Well. It's just, yeah.
I don't know if she's there now. For a while, and now I don't think this is now. They had Jasmine, Aladdin, and Genie come in and out. Oh. I never saw Babu. I saw Genie.
And I would imagine Aladdin making appearances, just like Beast would too. So that's cool. And the rabbit maybe coming out with Alice once in a while. I've seen pictures and such like that.
I think I've seen pictures of the penguins being out with Mary Poppins.
Sure.
Yeah. I was thinking of the white rabbit.
The waiter.
So jump into Magic Kingdom. We kind of have some of the same
characters, but some different. Up front at Epcot in World Showcase, go into the Imagination. There you're going to find Wreck-It Ralph. There you're going to find Joy and Sadness. Those guys are inside over there. And by the way, at the D23 Expo, somebody said, you know, we might have a Figment walk around coming, which isn't there yet. Where the heck is it? I wanted to see that at Festival of Arts, but.
You think that's going to work out well? I don't know how well he'll translate to a live action.
Is it going
to
be Figment actually walking around, or is it going to be the Dreamfinder walking around with Figment?
When they made the announcement that Grogu and Mandalorian were coming to Galaxy's Edge in Disneyland, the next sentence out of their mouth was, and we have a Figment meet and greet coming to Epcot. And it's not happened yet.
Rather have Mando.
I'd rather have Mando too.
The other thing, the weird thing about that, though, I mean, if you go on Journey into the Imagine the ride, I mean, Figment is like this big. I mean, how do you?
Yeah. Well, remember the original Dreamfinder held him. He was a puppet.
Well, that's it. So he's going to come out. I can assume he's going to have to come out with someone else. He can't be just.
Grogu came out with Mando. I'm thinking he comes out with the Dreamfinder. We haven't had seen the Dreamfinder in the park in forever. I had my fingers crossed we were going to see it at Festival of Arts. We did not.
I just saw this is recent. I might have even mentioned this on a previous show or a live show, but I saw a post on Facebook or something that said Disney will do everything they can to make money off of Figment except fix the attraction.
It's true.
They're bleeding that guy to death, dude. He's like the mascot for every festival. He's all over the place.
We just merchandise
art. I think you just go back to the original.
Do that, right?
Yeah. So I can imagine a nice dark ride with a lot of holographic.
You imagine that, we're going back to the original. But of course you would use modern day technology and your projection mappings and all of those things to get over the issues they had with the original one where that spinning turntable just didn't work. Kind of like the one they tried at Rise of Resistance, which lasts half a day, but that's a whole nother story.
Right.
You're right, though. If they went back to what the original ride was, but with newer technology.
Modern day technology,
it would be fantastic.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay, so we're almost done with some characters. Let's go to the Magic Kingdom because we do have some special characters over here, which I don't think you're going to see many other places. Ariel meeting her at her grotto, which is pretty cool. They put that whole area in for her. Merida at the Fairytale Garden, which is cool. Now, I've seen the Merida, what was it, the reading show or the... What's the thing she did over by the Cheshire Cat like shop? It was Merida's.
That's still her meet and greet area, but she did like a story. She did like a story time thing.
It was a show, but I think it's more just now signing the things.
But they have the animatronics of her brothers, the three bears. They're back in there and they move around. They're pretty cool.
Now I haven't seen that. I just saw a rumor she's going to be replaced with Mirabelle from Encanto. That is strictly rumor. That is nothing confirmed. But
right, I don't think she fits there.
I think there's other places they could get her where she'd fit.
Sure,
but yeah, I
Merida didn't necessarily fit there.
I put her over in Adventureland somewhere.
She's next to a castle. She's Scottish queen, princess, or whatever. That's pretty good.
Either way, it's
a castle. Let's not go overboard.
You get that new property that's just going bonkers. Disney's going to find a place to shoehorn it.
Oh, sure.
Next to it. That's what they're going to do.
So back to the characters now. I'm sorry. So this is one of the strange things now. As we look through the characters and I was doing a little research, I saw how they put some characters for meet and greets over at Pete's Silly Sideshow. So now that's the big tent, circus tent over in Toontown or whatever they're calling it now. And isn't it?
Storybook Circus.
Right.
Yeah, Storybook.
So now I thought that was such a sad thing. The first thing that came to my mind was Pinocchio and the circus and all the people that were getting kind of dragged in there and becoming workers now. So now we have all these characters over in the circus tent you can go get a meet and greet with. But Daisy's over there. Donald's over there. So, some other characters.
All circus themed. At least they were. I'm not sure if they came back that way, but Daisy had her poodles that were behind her, part of her circus act, and Goofy was there. Hey, he had just been shot out of the cannon. It was cool.
They also have the Mickey's meet and greet at the Town Square Theater up at the front of the park. That's definitely a big attraction that usually you have to get a pass for that, or is it just the line?
You can do the lightning lane for some of those things, is that no longer Talking Mickey, if I recall.
No, they did.
Mickey went away before the pandemic. That's just Mickey.
They did Talking Mickey for a while, and then I don't know. It's one of those weird things that they do, and then they just dump it.
There's always a reason for it. The technology's still there. They could have just been proving it. Now, for a while, there were two there. It was Mickey and it was Tinkerbell. The big push is. And I don't think Tinkerbell's there anymore.
And they were doing, Talking Mickey for a while. And then they were also doing Mickey and Minnie in specific costumes.
There was a 90th birthday costume. 90th and birthday. I think it was the... And it was the 50th anniversary costume. And I bet you any money there's going to be 100 years of Disney costume. Which, by the way, as I see more and more, I don't know if you guys have noticed this. Anytime I'm seeing a 100th anniversary Mickey, it's Steamboat Willie. I'm like,
interesting.
That's
so far,
cool.
Yeah.
So far, that's like it's the throwback. It's the Mickey Mouse is Steamboat Willie. I'm like, okay, sure. I don't know.
I want plain crazy Mickey.
You know what? That would be the...
That's the original. That's the OG.
Right? Wasn't that 1930s? Anyway.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see.
Play Crazy is cool. Which, by the way, I don't know if you guys saw any video, the queue for Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway in California. Absolutely amazing, that queue. And the hidden things in it. Speaking
there's
of planes,
a lot of stuff in there.
The plane's hanging from the ceiling. I'm like, are you kidding me? That's the Plane Crazy plane.
We talked about that on the last show, right, Ed?
You might have. If I wasn't here, I apologize.
A couple shows
but
ago.
We were talking about, you know, the queue and some of the stuff that's in there. But it fits so much better there because it's in Toontown.
In Toontown, absolutely.
And
right.
Disneyland. So the fit there is just amazing. Not that it's great where it is.
You got your fit for it's the premiere of the new cartoon at the theater.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, sure. But in Toontown, with that queue, it's pretty
awesome. Yeah, it's cool.
I heard they just today took the, you can just get on regular line now for Mickey Minnie Railroad out in California. I guess you had to do a virtual pass to set up line for it, but that stopped. so you can just get online normally now.
Yeah, they should. The rest of Toontown
is quick
opening there soon.
Mm-hmm. Well, remember, we always talk about, you know, Disneyland being more of a locals park. Yeah. So it doesn't take very long for those people to go see that attraction and the lines that kind of mellow out. Where, you know, it probably takes 2 years for a year at least for the lines to mellow out in Disney World because it's constant flow of new people coming.
I'm still waiting for dwarfs to mellow out. That doesn't happen. Yeah. Hasn't happened.
Well, Tron might mellow it out. I mean, yeah. Maybe.
Since I've been waiting since 1971 for Space Mountain to mellow out. That ain't happening either.
Yeah, exactly. So let's finish up these characters. You can meet all the princesses in the Magic Kingdom, which I think is pretty cool. And also another kind of meet and greet, which is nice for the little guys, is the Winnie the Pooh Tigger 2 meet and greet over by the Winnie the Pooh.
The honeypot's right over next to I love that one.
Yep. And you can see Jasmine over here too. Jasmine and Aladdin over at Adventureland.
Yep.
Now you're also going to see pirates rocking around. Captain Jack, I heard, was coming back or was back already over there in Adventureland. You're going to find different country bears walking around in Adventureland, Frontierland. So it's really kind of endless the amount of characters you get to see, which is always great.
Did we talk about Belle?
Yes. Oh, and well, we've talked about how they're back with the show.
Yeah. So, but that's a character meet and greet. But is it a show or is it a character meet and greet?
It's both.
That's more of a show. I think that's more of a show because you don't individually get her autograph and a picture with her, do you?
You do. At the end, you can.
Oh, I didn't know that.
After the show, you can hang out.
You can stick around.
Yeah, you got to stick around at the end.
I never took a small child through with me, so I never really paid attention to
that. Me either. I just wanted to go meet her. Next thing.
Yeah, interesting. Very cool to know. I would say that's both. That's a hybrid.
Me and Hilliard, my cousin Michelle's boyfriend, got picked to be we got picked. Well, I was trying to get him picked to be something, and the cast member noticed I was trying to get him picked, and she's like, "Oh, you too."
Yeah, that's a good cast member right there. I like that.
Yeah. Yep. So, it was fun.
Oh,
though.
You're both in.
Yeah, we got to be suits of armor.
That's great. I only did that once. I'm looking forward to going back because it's been a while. I remember the magic mirror was like, wow, that is so cool.
I was about to say, we were just talking about Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railroad, and it has something similar. And that the magic mirror that ends up being a doorway.
Yeah, it's just cool.
I still can't figure out how do they do it. I don't want to know.
It's right, magic. Exactly.
It's Disney magic. It's exactly it. And that's the answer that I have given many people that ask me, even if I don't tell them. I'm like, it's magic.
Sure. Disney magic.
Very cool. Okay, so let's move on to...
Ed's doing his best to keep us on track, Jimmy.
That's right. Let's move on to the last type of entertainment we're going to talk about tonight. And that is kind of... Well, we were going to talk about parades. We were going to talk about fireworks, but I don't think we're going to hit that. I think that's more along the lines of something else. So we'll save that for another show.
It is another show. We're going to talk about new fireworks coming, by the way. So that's cool.
Yeah.
I also think there are more obvious things that, you know, like the parades and the fireworks. I think most people have a basic understanding of those. And I think diving into some of the more obscure things is
right. The only thing I would ever really go in depth would be Fantasmic. And it was really cool to see that over Hollywood Studios, you have an 8 o'clock Fantasmic show. You have a 9 o'clock, what do they call the show they have over at Hollywood Studios?
There were two. I don't know which one's there now. So there was Movie Magic and the Animation.
And then they have another Fantasmic after, like a half hour after that show began. So there's a chance to see Fantasmic either before or after. It's not a choice anymore. Before, it was a choice to see either Fantasmic or the Star Wars show. I think that was cool.
Waiting for that one to come back. I don't think it's coming back.
No, I don't. It'll come back for special occasions. It'll come back on May 4th.
Or could they do a show in Galaxy's Edge? No, I mean, that's what we want, right?
Show on that too for Life Day. Maybe they do a celebration. I don't know. I don't know if they could. I don't know. Life Day celebration, sure. Make it up. Call Favreau. Put it in Mando season 3, and then it's canon, and then we'll do it. Still waiting for the Bad Batch to show up on Batuu.
I know. By the way, I would love that.
Mentioning Jon Favreau, isn't he the savior of all things we love?
So far.
He's like, a nerd savior. Like, he saved the Marvel Universe, and now he's saving Star Wars Universe.
Saving them from themselves.
Yeah. He just got we talked about this last week. He just got a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, he's a man.
Okay, so now, one of the other cool things that we had character-wise, live entertainment-wise, before the pandemic were the Streetmosphere characters. Now, when I say Streetmosphere characters, right away, the first park comes to my mind is Hollywood Studios, but they're not restricted just to Hollywood Studios. They are basically at every different park, and Streetmosphere are those characters that basically are just walking around the park. I would say at Magic Kingdom, Streetmosphere people would be the people on Main Street, the mayor, the fire chief, the singers, basically coming down the street, the drivers of the carriage and the bus and things like that. All great Streetmosphere.
There were two in Fantasyland that were almost similar to like the people that do the sing-along with the Frozen sing-along. They were like just royal people.
Oh, sure.
Like
they were kind of like the sing-along like, over the sing-along with Belle people or sing-along with Frozen people, where they just are basically introducing and their names are kind of off. I do remember those guys.
But they were like, they were like citizens of Fantasyland, and they would walk around and talk with people, and those are cool because they interact so well.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. So at Magic Kingdom, there's another really cool form of Streetmosphere with a musical side note, meaning you have the Dapper Dans running around, which are phenomenal barbershop quartet that are crazy good. You also have the Main Street Philharmagic has screwed me over for this word.
Yeah, that's
the
show.
Main Street Philharmonic, which is really, really good. It's a nice little small brass band that runs around. And they do some phenomenal tunes, too. I haven't seen the Philharmonic or seen any videos of them recently, post-pandemic. However, Dapper Dans are all over the place.
You also have the pianist outside of...
Casey's.
Casey's.
I saw the band at Christmas time, which was... I don't know if that was post-pandemic or not, but they were still up on the stage, completely separated, like it was their pandemic set. But they were there. They marched up together, but then they were all split up when they were playing on the stage.
Gotcha. But it's kind of cool. The pianists know each other.
They do.
I forget who I was talking to, but maybe it was Carol or it was Bob. They're talking about the guy over at the Magic Kingdom and how they all definitely work together and they do side gigs outside the parks together and such like that. It's pretty cool.
Miss Carol definitely knows all of them, which is cool.
Yeah. So now, moving over to Epcot, Streetmosphere, that's a little bit different. We get a little bit more entertainment, I think, over at Epcot for some of these Streetmosphere characters, and they have changed over time. Now, we've got a couple guys, but at one point, I think almost every country had their own set of Streetmosphere characters. Right now, we've got Sergio over in Italy. We've got the music in Mexico, the...
Mariachi Cobra.
Right, the mariachi band. The Jaminators are still running around, which I think awesome. Is great.
They're the best.
When I was there in January, I actually stopped. They were right in front of the cafe right there by Guardians, right by the breezeway, the Jaminators. And they played for a while, and I got to watch them, and they're really good. They're really entertaining to watch.
You got a great stick.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
And they get moved around more than anything I know at Epcot. Those guys get moved constantly.
Sure.
For a while, they were on the mill stage during this whole COVID thing. And then they were back up front. And then they're over by Guardians. And then they're back over by Imagination. But go on your app, pick the top, go to entertainment, you'll find them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, no doubt. No doubt.
So Mariachi Cobra just celebrated like their 51st year.
Oh, yeah, they've been jamming. They were the main entertainment for the Epcot 40th.
They and Voices of Liberty are originals to Epcot. They're the only two that are original. But the Mariachi Cobra, they have albums that were recorded before they played Walt Disney.
I think they were playing. I guess they were playing in Disneyland.
Could be. The band's been going on a long time, and a couple of those guys I've seen for years and years and years playing in that band.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Very
what
cool.
What a gig. So cool.
I know, right? So now let's jump over to Animal Kingdom, which has Streetmosphere characters also, which never really think about them, called Streetmosphere. The biggest and most famous, which you always pray to see, is who?
Divine.
Exactly. Have you guys all seen Divine? I got to imagine, yes. I have.
Yes.
A couple times.
In person.
Yeah, yeah. Right, right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yes.
Divine is a Streetmosphere character who dresses like basically a tree. She has vines. She's green, got the makeup. And if she's standing still up against some trees and foliage, you might not even see her. Mm-hmm. Usually you look for the attendant. That's how you find Divine.
This is true. Up on the stilts and it's
her handler.
Like, wow.
And she's pretty cool. So now another cool type of Streetmosphere character we have walking around Animal Kingdom are the characters per the lands. So in Africa, you'll have African acrobats, African musicians. Asia, the same thing. It's really cool, and you never know who you're going to see next. There's a really cool stage across from it's tough to be a bug, kind of where that entrance is.
Yes,
that stage is awesome because you
have the Gaia Street Band is. Yes,
and when I was there was a harp player there that was pretty phenomenal. And every time I go, you're going to see this different type of entertainment. Another good stage is in Africa.
Yep.
As soon as you're walking in Africa, you have that big stage right in the middle of everything. You're like, why is that there? Well, there's a great reason for that.
Tam-tam drummers.
Dancers.
The
ladies come out and do a great job.
Acrobats are amazing if you can catch them. They're the best.
Mm-hmm.
They're so cool.
Very much so. And there's also characters, and we haven't mentioned this in the other parks yet, but they're in those parks too, that are special occasion, only there for once in a while type of Streetmosphere characters. And it's the type of thing like the Muppets Mobile Lab at Epcot.
Yeah.
Or the dinosaur, the automatic walking dinosaur at Animal Kingdom.
Oh, what was his name?
I blanked on it because I was trying to
figure it out.
Up the garbage can at Tomorrowland over at Magic Kingdom.
Push.
Push.
Push. Push was the garbage can.
Yeah.
Lucky was the dinosaur.
Lucky. Okay. Yeah. Dinosaur, yes.
Sure. And Disney keeps trying to come up with characters like that, which is always awesome to see.
Grogu, Figment. Oh, no, not yet. I'm trying, guys. I'm trying.
Well, yep. Grogu, but just not on this coast.
Too far from Imagineering.
Now at Hollywood Studios, and this is, like I said earlier, where I get the first inclination or the first idea when someone says Streetmosphere, because Hollywood Studios characters were phenomenal. The saddest thing is that they are no longer there. There was about 7-8 different characters who had different personalities that they played to the T, and they had different acts they would do at different parts of the streets of Hollywood. And
some of them big collaborations.
Yes, I did a big game show actually in front of Grumman's Chinese Theater. There was probably about 7 characters involved in it. There was about 8-10 different guests that were in it too, and it was a really, really fun thing. It was about a half hour worth of great fun.
I can't remember the guy's name that played the cop.
They have a police officer. They have a sewer inspector.
They've
got
the best. Is there anything there now? I know those guys were the best. I love them.
My favorite. Well, the cop. I can't remember his name. I knew his name. He was one of the guys in.
He was over at the Adventurers Club too.
Well, he was in just recently. Was in the Frozen sing along.
Oh, cool!
As one of the, but my favorite of all of them was Jack Diamond. He was the magician.
I
remember who you're
talking. I never saw Jack.
Jack awesome. Diamond, he used to bring out like a card table. He played the little bean game that had like the three thimbles and he'd pass them around and he'd play cards. And he also did a lot. He had this real New York accent. It was like, he was hilarious.
Nice. Another cool gig they did was for Rope Drops at Hollywood Studios.
Yeah.
They would let us into the park, past the ticket booths. You would get halfway down the street, they would put the rope there, and then they would have Streetmosphere characters come out and do some type of gimmick. One of my favorites was the director. a guy would come out just like a Steven Spielberg type director. He'd have a couple assistants and he'd be talking to the crowd. We were going to act like we were a rambunctious crowd walking into an amusement park for the first time of that day. And that was our scene. And then they brought us through the scene when the park opened up. It was great.
You know, you bring that up and it takes me back to Animal Kingdom, because Animal Kingdom used to do a show like that with a, they had like a truck and everything. I mean, it was like a big deal. They did a whole show and then you would follow the show. Yeah, you would follow the show into the park, and that's how they led you into the park.
Well, and that one's changed too. They did that originally right in front of the tree, where you would come up to the part of that hill right in front of the tree. That's where the rope was. They would do the show even to the point where Mickey was in a seat in the tree. They've since, well, not even since, but before the pandemic, it was right in front of the ticket booths, where the bus was, and then it would drive.
I think that's kind of where I remember it. I don't
Magic
think that
Kingdom would do the train show in front of the entrance. Okay. They would do the mayor would come out. They would introduce the family of the day. The train would come on. They would sing the welcome song, and we would do the countdown. And we would go in. I would get totally Street Mosphere characters there. Yep,
that was very fun. That was great. That's something that's missed, for sure.
Yeah, missed deeply.
Yeah, it's definitely more the personal. It's the personal thing. I mean, it's actors out there doing what they're supposed to do. It's a lot better than just clicking your ticket and walking through the door. You know,
yeah,
little extra. Okay, guys. So what did we miss? What kind of live entertainment do you like when you go to Walt Disney World? Let us know. Jimmy, tell everybody how to get in touch with the show.
You can email us at questions at thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds. Instagram at The Disney Nerds Podcast and Twitter at The Disney Nerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.thedisneynerdspodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys. So that's it for show number 474, all the live entertainment at Walt Disney World that you can have fun with. Stay tuned, because I guarantee we're going to be back with another show that's going to go over the live entertainment at Disney Springs, the hotels, even some of the fun things to do off the Disney property. We'll see. Okay, guys.
Property? What's that?
It's called Outside the Bubble. Okay, guys. For Jimmy, for Sam, this is Ed, and we're the Disney Nerds, and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Quaharini.
Kongaloosh. I'm headed to Springs to check out some of the entertainment.
Like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory. Mortals pay a token.